Hello, everyone. Good morning. My name is Katrina Lashley. I am Program Coordinator for Urban Waterways at the Anacostia Community Museum here in Washington, D.C. Thank you for spending a portion of your Saturday with us. Welcome to our first WEL lecture of the year, Water Block, Urban Design and Environmental Justice, being hosted at CURIOUS, the Coraline W. Whitney Science Education Center at National Museum of Natural History. I want to give you a quick overview of today's event, and then we'll move ahead. First, I want to place today's event in the context of ACM's ongoing environmental work. I'm going to introduce our guest speaker, Atianna J. Cordova. Then we'll move into our lecture portion. And then we're followed by a Q&A session with Ms. Cordova and our attendees who are in person and on Zoom. For those of you joining us on Zoom, we just ask that you add your questions to the Q&A panel. The Women's Environmental Leadership Initiative, or WEL, as we refer to it, comes out of the Urban Waterways Project. It started 12 years ago as an exploration and documentation of the relationship between urban communities and their waterways, and by extension, their natural world. The project is built on a framework that acknowledges that urban communities and rivers are reflections of each other, and seeks to explore the question that if waterways serve as a background or are completely invisible in the urban landscape, what does that mean for the people living along their banks? Through ongoing collaboration for community partners, we soon realized that waterways were one entryway into conversations about people's relationship to the environment, how they define and celebrate the relationship to the environment, issues of access and disconnection, and ongoing efforts of stakeholders actively advocating for the health of their larger communities. WEL came out of ongoing work that we've been doing. Through documentation and programming, we became very aware of the leadership roles held by women in many of these environmental spaces. Some of these women, through their efforts, have expanded definitions of environment and environmentalism, helped to challenge the traditional environmental movement, shaped the environmental justice movement, and effected change at local, national, and international levels. At the other end of the spectrum were women who were thinking of or just entered these environmental spaces. Regardless of where they were in their environmental practice, we realized that these women serve as an embodiment of a living history of the many ways people have defined and practiced environmentalism, all integral part of communities' histories and stewardship of place. WEL aims to play a role in building capacity for next steps in environmental leadership, providing a space and opportunity for women to meet not only as professionals, but also as people, guided by the themes of mentorship, education, training, and leadership. In this process, ACM serves as a tool, a convener, as women's expertise take center stage. Since its launch for the first summit in 2018, WEL programming has grown to include workshops, dinner and discussions, oral histories, and a publication aimed at middle schoolers, which highlight the work of some of the women we've documented. The WEL lectures launched virtually in the fall of 2020, so serve as another platform for the experiences and expertise of the various women helping to lead this environmental work. They provide us with an opportunity to peek into their perspectives, to explore the frameworks they use to engage their communities through connection to place, ecological and cultural heritage, current issues impacting their overall health, and visions of more sustainable, equitable futures. Today's lecture marks the first in-person event for WEL since the 2019 summit. Conversation will explore the intersection of environmental advocacy, design, and urban planning, framing them in the acknowledgement of the history of spaces and places, the importance of uplifting ancestral and local knowledge, and recognition of the value of art and culture in design practice. Our guest speaker, Atianna J. Cordova, is an award-winning designer, entrepreneur, and educator from New Orleans, Louisiana. After Hurricane Katrina in 2005, she witnessed the exclusionary recovery practices that resulted in the displacement of many Black New Orleans and worsened pre-existing inequalities. While attending a high school architecture program, she was able to connect this experience to the lack of inclusion in the decisions made about neighborhoods and cities. In response, Atianna founded Waterblock in 2018. A design and creative studio that works to advance racial and environmental justice through community-led design and planning. In 2020, she formally launched Waterblock Kids, which teaches youth about architecture, landscape architecture, urban planning, and real estate through educational programs and products. Atianna is recognized as LSU School of Architecture's first McNair Research Scholar. Other honors include a 2016 UC Berkeley Undergraduate Prize for Architectural Design Excellence Travel Fellowship and a 2017 Salzburg Global Fellowship. Atianna is a co-winner of Propeller's 2018 Water Challenge Pitch Competition, a 2019 C40 Women for Climate member, a NOMA Board of Directors member, and a 2021 GRIS 50 Fixer. Please join me in welcoming Ms. Atianna J. Cordova to the podium.
Thank you, Katrina, and welcome everyone. Thank you for joining me today. So when Katrina first asked me or invited me to come and give a presentation about my work, one, I was excited, of course, because we're at the Smithsonian, so that's a big deal. But also because it's Saturday and the topics that we're talking about, they're not always friendly or lighthearted subject matter. So the fact that you all joined today in person and online, it definitely means a lot because y'all are my type of people that we try and get to the issues and really get, come up with the solutions that we can use to make our world more just. So I appreciate it. So it's already started. Okay. So as Katrina mentioned, my name is Atianna J. Cordova, and I'm just going to jump into my presentation. You took some of my little points that I'm going to be touching on, but thank you for that brief and warm introduction. So walking down the narrow and dimly lit hallway, I was puzzled by the silent expressions on the faces of my mom and grandma, auntie and uncle. This routine was normal. We drove 4 more hours into Texas, checked into a hotel room, and waited until it was okay to go back home. This time, however, the mood was different. There was no plans being made for the restaurant that we would try that night or who would be the first to get into the pool, just silence. As my uncle opened the door to our conjoined hotel rooms, my grandma yelled, "Have you spoken to them? Where are they?" This wasn't the first time my family decided to stay behind, since the last severe storm to hit New Orleans was Hurricane Betsy in 1965. Nonetheless, it was causing an uproar among all of the adults. Yelling, panic, and tears filled the room. And as my siblings, cousins, and I all stared at each other in confusion. Then a report from Anderson Cooper flashed across the television, quieting the entire room. Images of the familiar street signs, the neighborhood grocery stores, and parks that I used to play at were being undertaken by floodwater. People screaming from rooftops and dead bodies floating nearby resurfaced repeatedly across the screen. What was going on? What was happening to my city? It wasn't until that moment that it hit me, home would never be the same. This is an excerpt from a submission I gave to the 2016 UC Berkeley Prize entitled Safe Place. When I was a little girl, I had 2 ideas of what I wanted to be when I grew up. The first being an artist. You see, I was that child. I was a child that was always making something, always drawing something, fixing something, from jewelry to painting to drawing to dancing. I loved it all. From an early age, I developed a love for the creative process. I loved being able to see ideas that were once in my head come to life, to be able to express myself without even having to speak. The second thing that I wanted to be, which is completely opposite of the spectrum, was a dentist. I always thought that the dentist was one of the scariest doctors that you could go to. Something about them being so close and personal in your mouth, I was not feeling it. But my dentist always had a way of making me feel comfortable. She was also obsessed with penguins and the North Pole, so it didn't hurt that she mimicked her entire office off of this theme, which made it feel less like a doctor's appointment. In 2005, when Hurricane Katrina hit, my 12-year-old life and ultimately my career focus completely changed though. My family was fortunate enough to leave town right before the storm hit, like I mentioned in the earlier conversation. And over the course of about 2 years, we ended up living in a few different cities in Texas because we were unable to go home. These cities included San Antonio and surrounding neighborhoods around Dallas. Texas was cool, but it just was not home. My mama can attest to this, and she's sitting here today, but I used to beg her probably almost every day to take me back to New Orleans. And then one day she finally gave in. So in 2007, my little happy little kid's heart was on its way back home. And when I got home, for some reason, I don't know why I thought that it would be the same home that I remember once I left. And when we moved back to the city, I noticed that things were different, to say the least. And as the curious child that I was, I had questions. So I wanted to know what happened to our neighborhoods. Why did some neighborhoods flood and others did not? Why was the world calling us refugees in our own country? And why were people that looked like me still not able to come back home? During this time, I was just starting a high school architecture program, and I was invited, to attend a high school architecture program for the summer. The program taught me about architecture and the built environment, which, as I learned at the time, is the parts of our environment that are made by humans. At this moment, it was as if a light bulb went off for me. Like, wait a minute, you mean to tell me that there's a whole group of people deciding the policies and physicalities of our neighborhoods and cities, and the majority of people don't even know about it? Even further, you mean to tell me that the recovery practices that permanently displaced thousands of Black residents from New Orleans following Hurricane Katrina was intentional and somehow or another connected to the lack of inclusion in the design field itself? So just for some context, I attended an art high school. And when I returned to school after that summer, I had to declare a research topic for my visual art thesis project. I decided to use art as a medium to unpack this secret profession that I had just learned about and to uncover the changes happening across the city that I still didn't understand fully. As I started diving into this research, I was like, okay, there's a lot of white faces here. Where are the Black people? Given that I come from a predominantly Black city, but also where are the Black women? And as I'll talk about later in this presentation, there was a reason why this was so hard to find. My mama always told me to run towards the things that make you upset because often that's where your passion lies. So fast forward, I majored in architecture in college. And naively, I thought I was going to enter school and find ways to use design for good. However, that wasn't exactly the case. And as the only Black woman in my graduating architecture class, this became one of several issues that I would face while during that time in my life. But instead of getting discouraged, I decided to pivot. And I found ways to explore the type of design work that I was passionate about outside of my department. In doing so, as Katrina mentioned, I became recognized as LSU School of Architecture's first McNair Research Scholar and a UC Berkeley Undergraduate Prize for Architectural Design Excellence Travel Fellow. Yes, long title. Through these programs and building upon my high school research, I examined the relationship between architecture and homelessness in New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina and the sheltering strategies used to assist those affected by the 2010 earthquake in Haiti, respectively. By examining the culturally led recovery efforts in both places, I was able to highlight how design practice that centers the needs and desires of people creates opportunities to advance social and environmental justice. Historically, Black, Indigenous, and low-income communities have been excluded from the decisions made about our built environment. These groups are the target of discriminatory environmental practices and disproportionately impacted by environmental harm. The intersection between racism and design and the built environment is a part of the primary building blocks of this country. For generations, urban planning, policymaking, architecture, and landscape architecture, to name a few, have been used as tools to further oppress and marginalize people. Collectively, the related professions determine what resources are allocated to our communities, how communities are planned and designed, and ultimately who benefits or doesn't benefit from these decisions. Like many occupations in the US, architecture is a profession that is heavily dominated by white men. As of December 2018, the National Council of Architectural Registration Boards reported that there were over 115,000 licensed architecture practitioners across all 55 jurisdictions here in the US, including the District of Columbia, Guam, Puerto Rico, US Virgin Islands, and the Northern Mariana Islands. Out of this total, roughly 35% were reported as being women. Now, NCARB doesn't provide specific data as relates to gender and race, but the Directory of African American Architects, which was at the time was sponsored by the Center for the Study of Practice at the University of Cincinnati, indicated that there were 2,200 self-reported African-American architects out of that 115,000. Of this total, roughly 1,800 reported as being Black men, and only 462 reported as being Black women, which equates to this number we see on the screen, 0.4%. So 0.4% of African-American women at the time in this country were licensed architects. So we're not even talking about 1%, like 0.4%. So yes, you read the number correctly. And honestly, it's saddening, but also this is a similar discrepancy across design fields, including architecture, urban planning, landscape architecture, and other professions that impact our natural and built environment. So when we think of all the places that we frequent, such as parks, our schools, movie theaters, doctor's offices, hotels, our homes, even this building, and the leaders involved in making those decisions, it is largely homogeneous. This systematic exclusion and upholding of whiteness continues to have harmful impacts on Black people and those that don't identify as this majority. And in turn, this traditional mode of design practice only perpetuates and supports the dehumanization and killing of people who don't identify with this majority and those with intersectional identities related to race, class, and gender, to name a few. This becomes even more evident as we examine design decisions related to housing, education, food, transportation, and environmental health. In the 1930s, a U.S. federal legislation known as redlining was used to racially segregate American cities. Through this policy, government maps were created to indicate where Black people lived and in turn, where not to invest, which meant that Black people were denied loans that could have been used to buy homes. Land ownership is arguably one of the best ways to build generational wealth. And as a result, Black wealth is hardly a fraction of that of whites, which contributes to the wealth gap that we see today. Although this policy is now technically illegal, it has fostered many of the economic and environmental conditions we see in Black communities today. Like in education, we can also see how these racist housing and urban planning decisions continue to impact our schools and educational system itself. Generally, more valuable homes have more adequately funded schools, which in turn means more resources and better outcomes for students. According to the National Center for Educational Statistics National Assessment of Educational Progress, less than 1 in 3 students, white students, attend a high poverty school, compared with more than 7 in 10 Black students who attend a high poverty school. This discrepancy contributes to educational performance gaps between Black and white students, and ultimately their future career trajectory and livelihood. As it relates to transportation and food access, Black people are more likely to live in food deserts or areas that have limited access to affordable and nutritious food also because of these urban planning and racist housing decisions. And as it relates to environmental health, Black people are disproportionately impacted by environmental harm. And for example, people of color are 2 times more likely to live in a home without safe drinking water, modern sanitation. And across the country, community outcries for clean water, clean air, and clean soil continue. These examples clearly illustrate that the design of the built environment impacts every aspect of our lives and contributes to our social, emotional, and economic well-being. Yet design leadership does not reflect the diversity in our communities. And as a result, the historical impacts of design decisions have included racist housing practices that segregated neighborhoods and limited Black wealth building opportunities, highways built by eminent domain through Black neighborhoods, the destruction of Black business districts, historic neighborhoods, epicenters, and cultural spaces, the militarization of police, mass incarceration, and increased patrolling in Black neighborhoods, inequitable access to public transportation and fresh food in Black communities, polluted neighborhoods and environmental health risk, housing disparities accelerated by disasters, the displacement of Black people from their neighborhoods, and the list goes on. If we really take a holistic look at the practices around housing, education, employment, health, and the environment in this country, we see that none of this data is coincidental. And today, these interconnected assaults continue to slash through, kill, and uproot people from their neighborhoods, which produces and reinforces place-based inequities and injustice. For example, on the West Coast, residents of the South Los Angeles neighborhood of Watts are afraid to let their children play outside because of lead contamination risk from living on a former industrial site. In this area, actually, I want to do a pop quiz. Does anyone know what this is a picture of? Anyone in the audience? No? Central Park, right? So before it was Central Park, it was known as Seneca Village. And this was the area where Black property owners lived. They were forced to leave their homes and town to make way for the construction of Central Park. In Treme, noted as the oldest African-American neighborhood in the U.S., Black residents still grapple with the construction of the I-10 Expressway in New Orleans, which destroyed the longest span of live oak trees in America and destroyed over 200 African-American businesses. And here's a quote from one of the leaders in that community that says, "As a way to recover from planning decisions that have negatively impacted the Treme for generations, a predominantly African-American community with thriving businesses and beautiful homes, once considered Black Main Street, experienced a sharp economic decline when Interstate 10 above Claiborne Avenue was erected. Beautiful sprawling oak trees along the promenade were torn down, which was the longest span of live oak trees in America. And with them came the demise of over 200 African-American businesses, which served as the economic heart of the African-American commerce in New Orleans, and an epicenter of jazz, the civil rights movement, Black entrepreneurship, and family life. On the East Coast, residents of the Mott Haven neighborhood in the South Bronx suffer some of the highest rates of childhood asthma in the United States because of air pollution, as residents inhale the emissions of the hundreds of daily trucks that go in and out of that neighborhood, and the exhaust emitted by constant traffic on the nearby highways. In the Greenwood District in Tulsa, Oklahoma, also known as Black Wall Street, and one of the wealthiest Black communities in the US at a point in time, Black residents were viciously attacked and their homes and businesses were burned and destroyed to the ground. And coming back home to the South, Gordon Platt's residents in the Ninth Ward of New Orleans continued to demand the relocation from the toxic landfill that they were sold homes on top of by the city. Beginning in the 1970s, just for some context, this predominantly Black neighborhood was the predominantly Black residents were encouraged to buy into the opportunity to own suburban-style housing on the upper Ninth Ward of New Orleans. Unknown to them, these homes were built on top of the agricultural street landfill, which was later denoted by the EPA as a 100-acre Superfund site containing over 140 cancer-causing hazardous substances and pollutants. While many residents have unfortunately passed away from the emotional and physical harm done throughout the years, the current residents are still advocating to receive a fully funded relocation from the site. Typically, mainstream media depicts these stories as isolated incidents, but they are not. The environmental challenges in Black and Brown communities are not coincidental, but they are a part of a larger systemic issue. And these impacts all point to the issue of structural racism in this country. Architects have a positive duty to protect the health, safety, and welfare of the public, but history highlights the need to evaluate exactly which part of the public is being referenced. Historically, our public has never opted or operated as a unified front encompassing all people and all ideas. And traditional design practice solely amplifies this divide, which was the premise of my 2019 keynote during the New Orleans chapter of the American Institute of Architects, CE University. If we are to radically shift the paradigm of design and design professions, we must acknowledge the historical harm and act now. Now is the time to eradicate toxic social conditionings that restrict Black people's ability to move freely through spaces and places, which triggers embedded trauma and at times the killing of Black bodies. Now is the time to release Black people from blame for systemic wrongdoing created and upheld in the built environment. We shall no longer accept false narratives that blatantly ignore American history. Black people are not to blame for structural racism, nor the impact it continues to have on the livelihoods of Black people. Now is the time to actively balance joy and justice. The image of breathless Black bodies in private and public spaces is forever etched in our minds, and the inherent trauma is a part of our daily lived experience. Simply, this is heavy, and Black labor, emotionally and physically, has always been exploited. Take time to rest and prioritize self-perseverance in the midst of justice, because this is also part of the resistance, which is a founding principle of one of my favorite Instagram accounts, the Nap Ministry. Now is the time to also demand, how will you ensure that Black people's health, safety, and welfare are protected? And ultimately, what are you willing to sacrifice for it? Now is the time for design to be redesigned. Now, so far, this presentation may seem like a bashing session about design and the related professions, but I promise you it is not. This is, however, a reflection about where we've come from, because in order to move forward, we must be willing to acknowledge our ugly truths as a country, while still seeing the opportunity to do things better than they've been done before in the past. To leverage architecture and design to create more just communities that promote physical, emotional, mental, and social well-being for all. To be comfortable with being uncomfortable. To be willing to challenge our traditional roles and to serve the whole public and not just parts of it. In an effort to do just that, I founded Waterblock in 2018. Waterblock is an urban design and creative studio that works to advance racial and environmental justice in our built environment through design, community engagement, and planning. Waterblock was created out of necessity and the unyielding belief that we all deserve to be a part of the decisions made about our built environment, and that these decisions should be community driven. In practice, we lead with the question, how do we make design more accessible? Water Block highlights the importance of varying perspectives in design work and provides a space for communities to build their own capacities to address challenges in their neighborhoods. We do this by acknowledging the history of spaces and places, by seeking perception of problems to ignite community-based solutions, centering and uplifting ancestral and local knowledge, and highlighting the value of art and culture in design practice. Our work is heavily reliant on local knowledge and understanding that everyone enters design and environmental conversations from different places and different experiences, and that there are a vast range of ways that people prefer and want to be engaged. In part, this is why our approach is geared through the lens of art and culture, which provides a medium to break down barriers and connects people in relevant ways, ways that transform communities by elevating narratives that are often ignored, providing a space for community healing and creating collective visions for the future. We don't view our work in a silo of just design or another category, but a part of a larger regulatory plan for racial reconciliation and economic development, which looks at expanding leadership demographics to include Black, Brown, Indigenous people and youth and others that don't identify as a majority, minimizing the gap between the public and decision makers, creating alongside communities instead of for them, and being willing to challenge traditional ways of doing. This also means examining how policies and initiatives address or perpetuate barriers of access, and exploring ways to be more inclusive about the decisions that happen in our built environment. In this work, being able to adapt and change is key, which starts by listening and centering the voices of the people that your work will impact. Our communities are unique, so should our solutions. Water Black Kids is the youth arm of our work, where we teach elementary age youth about design through a social justice lens. Water Black Kids leads with the question, how can kids design a better world? A more just world that allows them to fully thrive in the future. Water Block Kids has four main focus areas. The first being architecture, the next being landscape architecture, then urban planning and real estate. So once again, looking holistically at the different careers and professions that impact our built environment and how do we get kids involved in the conversation at earlier ages. We believe that we are doing a disservice to our kids by not teaching them about design because it is literally connected to every aspect of our lives as we've seen throughout the presentation, which is why we believe that design should be a fundamental part of a child's learning and every child's learning. We have four main goals with Water Block Kids. The first is to build awareness and understanding about design careers and their direct impact in our communities. Next is to advance creative problem solving, design and critical thinking, and project-based learning skills to address real-world challenges. The third is to highlight Black, Indigenous, and Brown design professionals who are significantly underrepresented in design and design careers, as we also saw earlier in the presentation, and to affirm the identity and involvement of youth in the decisions made about our built environment. Our slogan is water our kids and watch them grow. Optimism and hope for future generations is what keeps me connected to this work. Because if it was the work alone, I probably wouldn't make it, to be honest. It's the belief that we can create a future where those most impacted by environmental challenges have the capacity to overcome them. A future where our children are culturally mindful and able to think critically about the conditions in their neighborhoods and cities. A future where our communities foster conditions that we can all thrive in and not just some of us. We have three main offerings within Water Block Kids. The first is our summer camps, which take place during the summer, obviously. Our workshops, which take place throughout the school year, and our educational products. We're excited because this is the second time we're saying this in public, but we just released the first book within our series for Water Block Kids and is entitled, What is Architecture? So a brief synopsis of the book. So the main character, which you see on the screen, her name is Ava. So Ava is a curious kid with a love for art. While attending a new summer camp, she reflects on the question, what makes a happy building? So in this book, you could join Ava as she learns about architecture and the world of design in this first book of a four-part series. And the book somewhat mimics my journey throughout design and my introduction to it as well. So if you'd like to purchase a copy of the book or even donate a copy to a child, you can visit our website at waterblockkids.com, or you can scan the QR code on the screen too to get more information. So also, if you would like to connect with us or contact us, we're on social media at Waterblock Global and Waterblock Kids. And you can also visit our website at waterblockglobal.com or waterblockkids.com. And also you can connect with me personally on LinkedIn as well. So that was a lot. And I know it's a Saturday too, so I want to thank you all for sticking through with the presentation, both in person and online. But if you did make it this far and you refuse to surrender to the notion that this is how things have always been, so this is how they'll always be, I want to encourage you to join our tribe. This work takes a village, and we'd be happy to have you to be a part of ours. Thank you to everyone in attendance, including my mama, who is has always reminded me throughout my life that God will make room for my gifts. I definitely appreciate that. And he sure does, girl, because we have the Smithsonian. And a special thank you to Katrina Lashley, the Smithsonian staff that I have met and haven't met, but I know they're working hard behind the scenes, and those putting in the work for a more just future. Thank you.
Hi, my name's Jolene, and I'm currently a master's student, and my research is looking at what causes people to evacuate hurricanes. And with your experience in hurricanes, I just wanted to know if you have any advice to help people that may find it difficult to evacuate hurricanes, and the people to decide to stay, how to help protect them while they're waiting it out.
So are you trying to explore the reasons, like why they can't leave the city, or?
Well, my research is just kind of like a quantitative, just looking at what influences people to evacuate. So it's more just seeing the factors that affect it, but knowing some of those factors, it's usually people that can't afford it or don't have transportation. So how to support those people, whether they stay or go.
Yeah. So, I mean, even as I shared in like my story with my family, there was some of us who decided to leave. I mean, I was a child, so I didn't have a choice in the matter at the time. So my mom said we're leaving, so we left. But there's also family members who did not leave, whether that be because they just thought, oh, this is going to be another hurricane, you know, it's going to pass by, or they didn't have the means to actually get out the city. So regardless of where people are on the spectrum, I would encourage you look at ways that they could just develop a plan, no matter what that plan is. If they're going to stay or if they're going to leave, what is your plan? If your house starts to get, you know, flooding, or even if the storm threat is so severe, are you going to go to a different location within the city? Are you going to do you have the resources stocked up at your house to even ride out a storm, the impacts of a storm for weeks, days, whatever it might be? So I would say help them curate what that plan is for them. And like you said, there's so many different factors as to why people choose to leave or not leave. But I think having that plan still is a helpful resource to have in your back pocket just in case.
Okay.
Because you will need it somehow. Yeah. So does that answer your question?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much.
What school are you attending?
The University of Georgia.
Okay. Well, congratulations too. I'm glad you're in this space. We need more young people too. So.
Cool. Thanks for the great talk. I'm wondering sort of what your thoughts are on sort of New Orleans local government right now, and whether, you know, they're adopting sort of a more inclusive design process that actually brings the people that will be impacted by their decisions into the process, or whether they're kind of sticking with the same old top-down, you know, not representative decision process. So,
yeah. Are you familiar with New Orleans? Can I ask?
No, I'm not. So I'm just curious. Yeah.
Okay. So this is something I think about all the time, of course, because I'm still based in New Orleans as well. And I think we're going through an interesting like shift in the city. So right now, I feel like we have a lot of conversations happening on the ground level as far as how to change things for the better, because we are still dealing with the impacts of Hurricane Katrina, even though that was, you know, since 2005. But I think it's a transition because there's a lot of people who know how to talk the right talk, but they're not walking the right walk, if that makes sense. And I think really deciphering who's really in it for the people versus who's in it for the media, the money, because there's a lot of money in disaster recovery and community development. It's like, that's the main divide that we're seeing right now. And as far as the solutions go to those problems, we are having more people interested in actually doing community-led design work. A lot of that work is related to stormwater management, which a lot of our projects focus on because we do have a huge flooding issue in the city. So getting communities involved in ways to help reduce that flooding impact in their neighborhoods. But once again, there's people who are walking the walk. There's also people who are talking the talk with that. So I think it's just more so, you know, we're on different sides of the field right now and trying to distill who is like the community leaders and doing it for the right reasons. I think another challenge with that though is that because people are getting so accustomed to doing projects like a certain way, because a lot of people are new to this space of community design. So they'll learn how to do a project a certain way and they'll think that, okay, this solution is gonna work in every single neighborhood across New Orleans or even in other parts of the country. And as we know, that's just not realistic or even, you know, viable solution to put forward. So I think it's more so too, getting people out of this mode of like, this is how I did it, so I'm just gonna replicate it somewhere else and keep the funding stream going. And instead having leaders and people who are dedicated to approaching every community as if it's a new starting block and saying, okay, what are the assets in this community? What are challenges are they trying to address? What challenges are going unheard or unseen? And how do we really use their voices to lead the design process? Not our own ambitions or our own desires for those communities. Did I answer your question? Okay.
We have a question for online.
First of all, thank you for your work, Atianna. What are the mechanisms for community engagement with building processes? Does Water Block serve as an advisory group on design processes, plans, and policies with local governments?
What's the first part of that question?
What are the mechanisms for community engagement with building processes? Does Water Block serve as an advisory group on design processes, plans, and policies with local governments?
Yeah, so we work on government projects as well as locally operated projects. And we work basically on the design team for those projects. So instead of just coming in, as a member of the design team saying, hey, we're gonna like draw out this space or we're gonna do X, Y, and Z, we make sure that community members are involved in the entire process. So as far as one, even letting them know that a project is coming about, or two, letting them know where they can plug into that project as well. So whether that be through workshops, whether that be through pop-up experiences, we basically work to make sure the people are leading the design process. But in a lot of ways, we are like the bomb on the team. Like we come in and we kind of like shake things up and we make sure that the people are really at the center of all decision-making that's taking place for the project.
And could you give examples of the pop-ups that people could experience with Water Block?
Yeah, definitely. So we're working on a project right now in New Orleans and it's a stormwater management project. But we have this site where it's one of the last undeveloped pieces of land within city limits. And with that site, it's a wetland. But a lot of people in the surrounding neighborhood and even in the city, they don't even know about the site at all. So what we're doing is we're working with community members, one in the immediate neighborhood, but also throughout the city, to get them involved in the project and aware about the space and what's about to come from it. And with that, we understand that a lot of people didn't know about the site. So instead of just having events and workshops within the neighborhood itself, we did pop-ups at grocery stores. You know, what we knew there was a lot of foot traffic. So understanding where are people and how do we meet them where they are within the community. We did pop-ups at pharmacies even, you know, like just trying to understand where are people walking? Where are people talking? Where are people just going throughout their days? Because we also understand that civic engagement is a luxury at best. A lot of people, working families don't have time always to attend a formal workshop or a formal presentation, but we know they're gonna be at the grocery store. We know they're gonna be at the libraries. We know there's certain places where we can meet them and have them be a touch point to us with the projects that we're working on. So that's an idea of some of the pop-up type styles that we do within our work.
Questions in the room?
So thank you so much for your talk. So my question is, and again, I came in late, so I apologize. My question has to do with the work that you're doing in New Orleans is incredibly groundbreaking. But I imagine that with global warming, we're going to see these sorts of things happening in cities, not even New Orleans, mm-hmm. right? So communities are going to be dealing with this, even in places that they never thought they'd be dealing with this. So do you have, or have you developed kind of a coalition that's broader, say across the country, where you have people are coming to you saying, we're just trying to anticipate that something like this is going to happen and we have no idea how to prepare people for this. And you have had many years to prepare for this.
Well, thank you for that question too. So actually, yes. So we also work, we have different networks in which we work within. Our home base is of course New Orleans, because that's where I'm from and that's where the company is placed. But I'm also a part of a group called the National Organization of Minority Architects, where I sit on the executive board. So with that, there's a lot of people within that organization who are also at the forefront of these types of conversations about changing design practice and making design, using design for good in those ways and really pushing the envelope around racial and environmental justice. So even with within those groups, we do a lot of cross collaborations, where whether that be digital work, even just like informative like this, getting people familiar with the topics themselves, or serving as an advisory role to certain projects too. So yeah, we definitely have spanned outside of New Orleans and you know, really just being a resource where people are needing us. But also if you have ideas for other opportunities, definitely feel free to reach out to. Yeah, you're welcome.
Hi, I'm Peter. I have a question about the intersection of disability issues with all these other issues you're talking about, because I know that a lot of people with disabilities face unemployment and underemployment and poverty and sort of physical accessibility as well as inclusion challenges. And that seems very similar to a lot of the issues that you've been talking about. So what do you think is the right way to for policy making to and development of opportunity to be more equitable toward people with disabilities?
Yeah, well, thank you for that question. And I'm glad you brought that to the forefront too, because that's another, like you said, another population where they basically just get pushed to the side or completely ignored when it comes to design. So I think the main thing goes back to just listening to people and understanding that your stakeholders are diverse. It's not just a certain set of people. Only the people that show up to workshops or show up to community meetings are the representatives of that community. You really have to be intentional about looking at, okay, who's in the room, but also who's not in this room. And you have to constantly check yourself as you're doing this work to understand that, yes, this may be the people that showed up, like even today, you all the people that showed up, this doesn't mean that this is where the information stops or where this education needs to be shared beyond. So you have to constantly and always be asking, how do I go beyond the four walls of this space? How do I go beyond what's traditionally been practiced within this discipline? So I think that is the main intention you have to lead with, and you have to be intentional about that. And there's a lot of designers who could not care less. They're going to get paid regardless if four people are in the room versus 100. So they don't care about that type of depth and that type of consideration for human life. I think it really takes the right designers to actually understand that you have to constantly be checking yourself and who's not in the room at all times in order to have a project that really encompasses a diverse range of people. Does that answer your question? Mm-hmm. If you have another one, feel free to add on to it. Okay.
Okay, Atianna, we have another question from online. Thank you for your work and this inspiring presentation. Do you have recommendations for how science organizations like the museum, scientists, and science educators can be allies in this work, especially those who want to do more but our passion is met with a response to stay in our lane or this is not science?
Ask the last part of that question one more time.
Especially those who want to do more but our passion is met with a response to stay in our lane or this is not quote unquote science.
I guess I have a follow-up question to that. Who exactly is saying like that statement? Is that like their work coworkers or some concept?
So let's see. If you want to add to your question online, but I don't want to assume, but maybe I'm assuming it could be colleagues or other, you know, maybe managers or supervisors.
I would say it goes back to that slide I showed. I probably could go, let's see if I can find it. I would say it goes back to this slide. So how will you ensure that Black people, but really you can insert any community of people, people's health, safety, and welfare are protected? And ultimately, what are you willing to sacrifice? I mean, yes, we all understand that we need employment. We need a job, of course, for our livelihoods in this country and just to get by. But at the same time, there are certain opportunities and spaces where you're going to be needed to be that person, that voice, that rebel that's shaking things up in the room. And it's not to avoid the challenge that she's, you know, or he has commented on as far as it being a space where they don't feel supported in doing so. But I think it goes back to like, what are you willing to sacrifice at the end of the day? And finding the ways in which you can actually be that voice on that team that is changing things or trying to do things for the better. So I would just encourage them to stay the lane if they're feeling passionate or feel a calling on their life to actually be that voice, so don't run from it or find a different space where you actually can be that voice. and find your people, find your team, find people that are going to encourage you to do just that. Because we need those voices in all spaces, not just in spaces where it does seem acceptable. And if I didn't answer their question too, please tell them to
follow. If you would like follow up, please type in. So I have a question about water block kids.
Mm-hmm.
So could you walk us through what would be a typical day with the water block kids and as part of a summer camp?
Yeah, so with the summer camp, so as I mentioned, we have four main areas with the program. So architecture, landscape architecture, urban planning, and real estate. So throughout the camp, basically kids are learning all four areas of the program. And by the end of the camp, they actually have a finalized project, depending on what the camp question was for that summer, where they're addressing an issue in their community or in their city that touches on all four of these areas. So it's a really like comprehensive program and pretty in-depth. The kids get a lot of information in that period of time, but they're learning about the different aspects that go into urban planning and the built environment. And by the end, they're presented with a design question and they have to actually solve it using design skills and design thinking.
And how do you recruit for your summer camps?
So right now, so during COVID, actually, we were virtual. So we had the blessing to be able to reach kids across the country. But mostly in New Orleans is a lot of the kids there. We partner with schools throughout the school year. They're able to attend the program. So it's more so just like local schools and local community groups that are getting kids involved back home in the city. You had another one?
So can you talk a little bit about some examples of engaging communities' histories or cultural practices? And you talk about this idea of, you know, the history of places and spaces. Mm-hmm. So what are some examples of water block kind of using those, I would say, pathways to kind of engage various residents in the issues that are really pertinent to their lives and their possible futures?
Yeah, so like that one project I mentioned back home that we're working on, that's a stormwater management project. So the site, like I mentioned, is one of the last undeveloped pieces of land within city limits. That's like unheard of for any city. So with that space, before even coming in and saying, hey, you know, we're doing this design project, we want to get your ideas for the space, we want you, you know, to weigh in on it. Our team stopped and we said, first, let's look at the history of this site. Like this has such a high historical significance. Let's understand it before even allowing people to like come in and basically impress their ideas and their wants and desires onto it. And by doing that, we started looking at the indigenous history of that land and the practices that it was used for, and then the Maroon history of that land and the practices that they used it for. And then really using those historical significances to one, inform people who may not know about you know, that history, but then also saying, okay, based on this information, now how do we start to merge our ideas, our desires with what's been done in the past, and really coming together to really envision what that future may look like for this site. But that's how we approach it, is really acknowledging the land that we're standing on, acknowledging the sites in which we're doing projects, and then really using community voice and advocacy to merge all those ideas together into a vision for what that site could be.
And follow up to that, how receptive are, I guess, the powers that be to that community history and vision and wanting that to be part of whatever comes next in terms of the next phase of the space?
So you already know part of that answer. You're smiling when you ask it. So you know it's not always easy. But like I said, that's part of the reason why we're brought to projects. People understand the paradigm that we're coming from. They understand the perspective. So if you come to us, you know it's not going to be a cookie cutter like, oh, you know, cute little project, here's your check. Like, no, we're going to come. We're going to really ask questions that really get people thinking and really, you know, make this a holistic project that reflects the community at best. With that being said, though, I think a lot of times, one approach that I found when doing projects like that where it is hard or you're coming up against forces that may be against the idea and whatnot, is people can't deny facts at the end of the day. History is factual at most times at best. But with that, when you present people with the facts of what it is that you're looking at, what you're doing, it's very hard for them to say, oh, but I think, okay, you think one thing, but the fact says this. I think that approach, being grounded in historical facts of this country, is historical significance of the different sites you're working within, it really straps you with the armor to enter those conversations in a different way. So even like with our work, when we were talking about the indigenous Maroon history, we had some people who were like, why is that important? And then we went to the facts and said, well, it's important because this land was once not yours. This land was not always called New Orleans. It was called Balvancha. So, you know, it's really going in with this historical recognition and these facts that really armor you to really make the case for your argument of why this stuff is important. So.
Question up.
Hi, so I have a question. Are there instances where community engagement can lead to negative outcomes? I guess I'm very familiar with
in this area, for example, people in Georgetown advocating against the spread of public transportation, people in Arlington right now advocating against missing middle housing, which would support people who don't necessarily have the resources to buy $1.7 million houses in Arlington. And, you know, thirdly, you know, in a related issue, you know, are there opportunities that are cut off? Let's say we don't build whether it's an office complex or affordable housing or other things on different lands, are we losing something in that process of engagement?
So are you more, let me just get clarity about your question. Are you more so asking when you do engagement the right way and with the right intentions, are there negative impacts to that process? Or are you saying engagement as a whole? A lot of people do engagement. Like what spectrum of engagement are you talking about?
I guess I'm talking about engagement as a whole, right?
Okay, so like the whole space of engagement.
Because a lot of folks will say things like, well, don't put that in my backyard, mm-hmm. but I'll do it somewhere else, right?
Gotcha.
And so it seems to me like there is some tension between, on the one hand, creating affordable housing, creating economic activity in the community versus, let's say, doing extensive consultation and engaging in other processes.
Okay, so if I'm understanding your question right, it sounds like you're more so trying to get clarity around like the responses that you receive from doing the engagement itself. Is that correct?
Well, I guess I'm just trying to understand so what's the right way of doing this problem?
So I think I wouldn't look at it as like polar opposites like that, like a right or a wrong way to do it. Like I said, the intention, I think it matters more heavily sometimes than rather it's a good or bad, because who's the judge? That's so subjective. So I think honestly, it's more so like, how do you create a space where regardless of what the commentary is going to be from the public or the stakeholders or those involved in the project, how do you create a space where all voices can be lifted up and provide them with a platform to actually contribute to the project in some way, whether that be good or bad? And honestly, as a designer, I'm not really a judge or in a position to actually judge what that input should be or should not be. I think it's more so how do you craft the space and really act as a facilitator to actually get those ideas and those ideas brought to the forefront. So whether it's good or bad, that's more of a subjective space that I would say to somewhat stay out of, but it's more so just crafting a space where different voices and different ideas can come together. And then as a designer, working with all that material and saying, okay, now how do we start to come up with a solution that starts to address all these things that we're hearing? Does that make sense?
Can we quickly jump back? Because the question I think kind of follows up a little bit on that. So it's clear there's a need to check oneself frequently throughout processes. How do we move on with the project without it breaking down due to conflicting voices? Because not all communities aren't monolithic. Mm-hmm. So you have different stakeholders, different visions. How do you move the work along, but you have voices saying this, that, or
So I think sometimes the curse with design work is that we're placed on these timelines, of course, where it's like, okay, we have funding for X amount of Z, dollars, but also we have to use those dollars within a certain time frame. I think sometimes that timing of things can get in the way, because when you do have instances where you have these conflicting voices and you're trying to come up with a solution, sometimes the best thing you can do is pause and really try to understand deeply what is going on here. Like, what is the reason for this tension and how it becomes to a malleable solution that really reflects different ideas and different voices. So, I mean, we've been on projects before where it's gotten to those tense points as well, where it's like, okay, what are we gonna do here? Because y'all are over here, y'all over there, and it's kind of 50-50. And I think really taking time to say, okay, let's take a step back. Let's understand like, what is your, not exactly what you're saying, but what is the goal that you desire? Over here, what are the goals that you desire? And really sometimes a lot of those goals and desires are the same. Like, I want a good community. I want a safe community. I want a healthy environment to raise my family and my kids. So really it's going back to like the fundamental things that both sides are really anchored in. A lot of times there's so many commonalities there. They're really trying to focus on what brings us together versus what's pulling us apart, and really reshifting the engagement process so that it's more so surrounded about that, rather than like, okay, you're on this side, you're on that side. And we're all in this together because this is a project that's going to impact all of us. But what are those core values that we can all kind of, you know, get on the same point about and work together to develop what it is that we're trying to develop? And it doesn't always go smoothly because we're dealing with people at the end of the day, but that is another way to kind of like restructure and reframe the process that you're going through with.
I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you.
So I wanted to ask you about the kids themselves and their receptiveness and like perception of the historical and like contextual part of your work.
Mm-hmm.
I want to center too on the fact that, you know, they're in New Orleans. So, and then as Black communities, we have our oral tradition. And so, how do I say, they're not new to the realities of the situation, but I think I'm curious with the intersection of, you know, this environmental work with the history and the context, what you've seen like on the ground with the kids and how they're absorbing the information and what they're doing with it.
Yeah, so we kind of approach the work with the kids the same way we approach the work with the adults, honestly, in a way where when we're talking about these conversations or introducing it to a community, it's never from like the slides I showed you at the beginning, where it's like, here's the history, here's the facts, let's jump into it. It's always from a touch point that a human can relate to. So like for kids, for example, kids, we know that they love animals. We know they love food, things of that nature, you know, like just simple things. So we'll, when we're doing workshops, for instance, we'll come in and we'll connect on those types of data points. And we'll say, hey, you know, like, what's your favorite food? What's the favorite food for your favorite animal even? And they'll start telling us their ideas, their different stories. And we do the same things with the adults, but they'll tell us their ideas, their stories. And we'll say, okay, what if you had to design like a park for this animal? What would you do? Or what ideas would you have for them? And they start, you know, going off the bat, oh, I'll do this, I'll do that, I'll do that, 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 that. And we're telling them like, do you know, there's actually people who do these types of things. So it's more so getting an entry point where they can relate and connect to and building off of that interest. So some may not be interested in animals, let's say. They may be interested in music instead. Finding a touch point that they actually can relate to and connect with and saying, okay, you're interested. Okay, let's keep baiting this. Let's keep building into this. So I think that's really how you have to enter the conversation. Never from the stance of like, I'm the expert and I'm going to tell you this and I want you to understand this because it's important. It's more so finding something that's relatable and saying, okay, let's have a conversation about it. What would you do differently? How would you design this differently than what you've seen in your neighborhood? And that really starts getting their gears turning. And I think with our program, what's been just brilliant to see is because it's not just educational based in that they're receiving information and then that's it, but they're receiving it, then they're being asked to do something with it. So that solution oriented aspect completely changes how they're processing it, because now you're seeing like, okay, we talked about this thing, but do you really understand it in a way where you can apply it to something? So that critical thinking, those design thinking skills, they're all being developed while we're doing those type of you know, workshops and engagements with them in that way. Yeah. You're welcome.
We have another question online, and you've touched on it in other questions as well too, but does your organization partner with other education nonprofits? If there's anything else you want to add in terms of your partnership.
Wait, say it one more time. Mm-hmm.
Does your organization partner with other education nonprofits? Anything else you want to add in terms of what you've already mentioned?
Yeah, so we, like I mentioned, we work with local schools. We've also did partnerships with schools across the country because during that COVID time period, and also the universities. So getting the universities involved, because we understand that this work, part of this work has to be a pipeline. It's not just introducing kids to this conversation at an early age in elementary school, which is what we focus on, and then saying, okay, y'all go on and y'all do whatever. It's more so how do we start to create that streamlined approach where it's like, okay, did you know, like you can actually major in this area or field if you're interested. And then they're like, what? Some haven't even heard of college before. And you're like, what do you mean? Like going to college, like, what does that even mean? So that even starts to open windows and doors, and having community partners such as universities and other educational groups, that starts to really become our like our grounding team, where we're like, okay, we have a kid that's interested in this. How do we get them the resources to do X, Y, and Z? How do we create the pipeline for that? And really tapping in once again to what their interests are and where they're trying to, you know, see themselves or go. And as I mentioned too earlier, so like with our work, even though we're covering the topic of design, we don't see this work, whether it be Water Black or Water Black Kids, in a silo at all. So we do like unconventional partnerships all the time, because this work, as we saw, is related to everything around us. If you're in science, if you're in music, if you're in whatever, you know, career field out there, it's related to design in some way, because we all live in neighborhoods and cities. So we do, yeah, unconventional partnerships all the time.
What has been your most unconventional partnership, or like one you would not have expected?
The most unconventional one. Oh, let me think about that one for a second. I'm gonna come back to it though. Most unconventional. I'll come back to that one.
Another question. Mm-hmm. So you talk about this idea of creating pipelines or pathways to career, to education. If you feel comfortable sharing your, in terms of your own personal experience, what was it like being being the only or one of few in predominantly, say, white male spaces? Mm-hmm. And, you know, where did you find your support, your network?
Yeah, so being completely transparent, like I mentioned, when I was in college, so I went to college at LSU and I majored in architecture. And through that experience, you know, I went into the program with this idea like, oh, I'm going to use design for good. Like I'm going to be able to explore the things I'm passionate about within this work. And I was met with a lot of, no, you're not. I don't know what you think you're doing, but you're not doing that. And with that, I could have got discouraged, like you mentioned, but I decided to instead think outside of just my department. I mean, I'm on a huge college campus. There has to be somebody here that can relate or understand the perspective that I'm trying to bring to this field. So with that, I started to look into a lot of external research programs. And I think research is a great opportunity where you can explore things and they'll just, you know, they'll give you the funding and the resource to do so. And you have more freedom in that way. So that's exactly what I did. So during my program, that's how I got involved with the Ronald E. McNair Research Scholars Program, because they have provided more flexibility for me to just research what it is that I was interested in. And with that itself, it goes back to that slide I showed a few seconds ago. It's like, what are you willing to sacrifice? Like, yes, you can get met with so much confrontation, so much like negativity around what it is that you're trying to do that you know is right. But I always encourage people just to find another way. There's always another way. Find another door, find your team, find your people who actually are going to be there to support you and build you up, because there are people out there. It may take a little harder or longer to kind of connect and find those people, but they exist in that way. Is that the full part of that question? Did I get the last part?
Yep.
Okay.
The other questions on site, we have some more in line. So
do the pop-ups get interest? Our community is apathetic because the voices aren't heard.
No, they get a lot of interest, actually. The pop-ups has probably been one of our most successful engagement tools. So because with the pop-ups, once again, it's not coming in and just saying like, hey, listen to this education and here are the slides and here's this thing. It's more so, you know, we're dressed down, we're just in the community and we're saying, hey, you know, how's your day going? And just having a conversation with people. So I think it's more so when you connect with people, once again, on that human level, where it's just about like, okay, I'm a human, you're a human, let's talk. What are some issues you're experiencing? What are some issues I'm experiencing? What's some things you love about your neighborhood? What are some things you don't? You really start to get the opportunity to build a further conversation because you're connecting on something deeper than just, I'm here to tell you about this thing or extract this type of information from you or whatever it is that, you know, traditional design practice supports. So yeah, the pop-ups get a lot of interest actually. And once again, it's meeting people where they are. So that always helps.
Thank you very much. Very inspiring. Huh? Other questions? We're here. So what are next major steps for Waterblock or Waterblock Kids that you're looking forward to, especially for the summer or the next or fall?
Yeah, this book, y'all. So like we mentioned, we have our first children's book that has just come out. What is architecture? And I'm very excited about this book because going back to my own story, as I mentioned, I was always a creative child. I was always making something, doing something. And part of the things I was making was books, actually, when I was little. So I used to write my own stories, draw my own pictures, all that good stuff. And I think this is probably one of my proudest moments because it seemed like it's come full circle almost. Like I started out as this kid doing all these creative things. And now it's like I have a tangible thing where I could be like, oh, I did that. So I definitely would say this book is probably the next big thing for our work. And we would love for you all to support it. All you that are in the room, share it with your friends and family. Visit the website, learn more about the program. And even if you're not interested in reading it yourself, you can also donate a copy because there's many kids who will benefit from that as well. So yeah, I would say this is probably our biggest and most exciting thing. We also have a project coming up on the water block side, the urban design side, where we're gonna be working with communities across New Orleans to basically give them the funding to implement their own project within their neighborhood that addresses a concern that they may see. So we're excited because with this, the grant that we received for their project is giving communities even more autonomy to decide what's happening, what it is that they want to actually implement. So I can't talk too much about it yet, but that's something else that we're really excited about.
Other on-site questions?
Another one here. Oh, an unconventional partnership question. But that one's rough because I feel like all of our partnerships come out of like just crazy areas. Like we've worked with like music teams, we've worked with I'm drawing a blank on like the exact ones which are like unconventional or the most unconventional. We work with like parade groups, we've worked with like government board, we've worked with so many different people. It's been it's hard to say what was the most unconventional, but yeah, we don't turn down any type of partnership if it exists there. We always try to find a way that we could collaborate in some way.
I have a question, because I know you have international experience.
Mm-hmm.
How does your experience going out into the larger world impact or influence the development of Water Block? And does it still impact and influence how you engage in your work?
Yeah, so when I was in college, going back to that question about, when you're met with discouragement or if you're the only one, how do you operate in those spaces? A lot of the support that I received was from, like I said, outside of my department here in the States, but also international groups. So when I was early on looking at that external research and how to find my team and how to build my tribe and how to explore the topics I was interested in, I also did a program under UC Berkeley, which I talked about, where I was able to travel to Haiti. And by traveling to Haiti, I was able to bring the research I was doing at LSU through that research program and look at it, how it positioned itself in the context of Haiti as well. And by doing that work, I was able to see the connections and overlaps and similarities and differences between looking at this work in New Orleans, architecture and homelessness versus the earthquake in Haiti and their displacement of residents, and really finding those overlaps in that way. So I would say the international lens definitely has influenced the development of Water Block, because I was doing that work before Water Block was even Water Block, or Water Block Kids was even Water Block Kids. So yeah, it's definitely been helpful. And we still do work too, where we're still doing educational workshops and things like that with other communities outside the US.
May I ask if you're willing to share some of your highlights from the findings of that work? I'd love to hear like similarities and differences between Haiti and New Orleans.
Yeah, so one, from a cultural stance, there's so many similarities between New Orleans and Haiti just because of the travel history, but also just the people who come from the same areas. So it's more so a thing of, I think it, because when I was in school, because I was like that only one and I was pushing issues and trying to bring up topics that really nobody was really trying to, you know, hear more interest about, it just solidified the idea that like the things that are happening in my community of New Orleans, the things that are happening in other isolated communities throughout the US, these aren't isolated incidences at all, even though they feel like it. So like when you're going through a Hurricane Katrina or, you know, quote, insert your own natural disaster or environmental concern, it feels as though like this is so personal. This is so like, why is this happening to me in my community? And it's more so when you actually step out and you start to connect with international audiences and you start to see, oh, wait, this is common here and there. Or this is like, you know, the same thing, just they're using a different word in this space. You really start to see like, wait, this is all systemic. Like, and that's really when, you know, that light bulb really goes off. But I can't tell people enough. It's like, we have to stop isolating these incidences as if it's like, oh, that's just the thing they're dealing with in the South. Oh, that's just the thing they're dealing with over there in that country. It's like, no, we're all dealing with these things. And there's more power when we come together to understand that. And really coming up with the idea of like, how do we start to work together and move these things forward? Because at the end of the day, going back to how do we build those commonalities as humans, it's like we're stronger when we move forward together, but also what the desires that you may want for your family and your community is probably similar to what I want for my family and community. How we get there may differ, but our core values and our core goals are probably similar in a lot of ways. So I would say definitely like with that work, which is more so many commonalities and overlaps where I was like, what? Like, I've been trained to think this is only like, you know, happening here, or I've been trained to only view Haiti in this way. And it's such a beautiful country. When I got there, I was like, what? Like, you know, you're basically unlearning everything you've been taught and ingrained to think. So I would say with that, you know, those international exposures and whatnot, it just helps you like get a better rooting in the work you're doing, but also just like connecting with people. It's like, no, this is all common, you know? Yeah. So
thank you.
You're welcome. Oh, and also too, just to add, because I'm thinking about the question the person asked online about when you're the only one, I would say too, when I was in my architecture program and I was about to graduate, I had a guy who, he was one of the first Black students to integrate LSU, and he came back and he was promoting his own book, and he was, you know, like talking to the students and things like that. And the quote that he shared that I never forget, and I say this quote all the time, was, he said, it's a time of celebration when you're the first, but it's a time of mourning when you're the last. So with that quote, it stuck with me, because as I was going through architecture, and that's an experience in itself, and I got stories today with that. But even when I was going through that experience, I was always thinking about, okay, the next generation. Like, I'm going through this, but I know God's positioning me here to make it easier for somebody else coming behind me. And I think you have to go in with that same understanding a lot of times too, like the trials and tribulations that I'm going through is not solely for my life and for my benefit at the end of the day. Sometimes you won't even see the benefit. Sometimes it's for a future generation that's not even born yet. And really staying true to that mindset and that ideal really helps give you that encouragement during those dark times, those moments where it's like, oh, this is a lot. So
we have another question on live and questions are on site. Okay. As a resident of New Orleans East, what can I do, no matter how small, to make a difference for the children in our community to engage them at a young age?
Come get connected with us. Join our tribe. You have no excuse now. Who is that? I'm like, tell me their first name. I will find them. We need more people. And like I said, with that project that's coming up with Water Black, that we're about to do those projects across New Orleans. So definitely email us, connect with us. We're looking for people on the ground who wants to get involved.
Yeah. Another question. Mm-hmm. As an architectural designer, could you suggest what kinds of firms we could look for where we could practice environmental justice through design?
Well, honestly, I'm not going to recommend or name drop any names in that space because I haven't worked for any other company, really. So after I graduated, I started my own company. And then because I did, well, let me back up and give context. I did a lot of internships with different companies across the US while I was in college. And during those internships, there were things I liked about those companies. And there was a lot of things at the core. I'm like, oh, this does not fit right with my spirit. I cannot be here doing this work. So with that, I would say I wouldn't name drop a specific company because at the end of the day, people come and go from companies. It's really about the principles of the companies. Like, what are they founded on? What are the things that they're making sure their employees embody that they're bringing to work every single day? So I would say, don't get so caught up with the names of this company's, you know, is the big name or that company's that. Look at what they're actually doing and what principles do they actually stand upon? And what are their non-negotiables too for projects? Some design firms, a lot of design firms, they'll accept anything with a dollar attached to it. And I think you have to get to the point where, especially if you want to do this type of work and do it justice, where you ask yourself, what are you willing to sacrifice? Like, are you willing to be a part of a project where you know that half the community does not know what's about to happen? Half the community is about to be displaced because of the investment going into the project and they're not gonna be able to afford the tech. You know, like, you really have to ask yourself those questions. And if you're not willing to sacrifice those things, then find another company that will support you and do that. So.
Question? Okay, another question online. How do you advocate for environmental justice funding and equity in STEM education funding?
So once again, the facts. I always go back to the facts because STEM, of course, the science, technology, engineering, and math. I always say STEAM because the A needs to be acknowledged. Art and architecture, that's what I expanded to include. But with that, I think once again, going back to the facts, when you present the challenges that we're talking about in neighborhoods and cities, it's very hard for people to deny factual information. And I'll just put it as simple as that. When you present it to them like, hey, I know you're funding these STEM educational products, but you know, architecture and art is also a part of that conversation. And this is how it is. And this is how it shows up in all of our everyday lives. When you armor with that type of knowledge and that type of information, the reason they're denying you is never going to be on because you didn't have the information. It's going to be on a whole other set of issues or concerns, but it can never be because, oh, you weren't qualified or you didn't have the information you needed, because this stuff literally touches every single subject matter. It's so widespread and it's so deep. And it's all interconnected. So I hope y'all actually took that away too from this presentation. It's just so deep and interconnected. No matter what topic you're talking about, design relates to it in some way, no matter what it is.
If one more in line, I see.
I think he had this. I don't know if he had his hand, but nice.
Okay. What are some groups in Atlanta, Georgia you recommend I join to be part of?
Atlanta? I'm not from Atlanta, but I don't know if they gave away or something, but to be a part of for what exactly?
I mean, part of the conversation, part of the work.
Well, if you want to join NOMA, so the National Organization of Minority Architects, like I mentioned, I sit on the executive board with them, and they have local chapters all across the country. So there's a NOMA Atlanta chapter that I would definitely say get connected with. This is part of the people that are having these same kinds of conversations. And if you really want to find other ways to even get deeperly involved in the work in Atlanta, I would say connect with them. And if you need help connecting with them too, feel free to reach out to me as well.
Last call for questions on site or online. Okay.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I say executive board. The board of directors for NOMA. But yeah, if you have questions, feel free to reach out to me. Okay. Thank y'all. Once again, y'all my type of people.
Okay, so our program officially is not quite done yet. So while our Zoom attendees will be leaving us, we've created space and time for you to continue your conversations with Ms. Atianna Cordova, also with each other. We have some snacks and refreshments in the Curious Lab for you to take on the way out. We just ask that you refrain from eating in the center. More importantly, Atianna, I wanna thank you for not only sharing your work today, but also your personal experiences, which have shaped your environmental practice. I think, and it's important to understand that for many people involved in these various kind of environmental spaces, the why of the work is very much shaped by who you are, where you come from, and the communities that you represent and you bring into these spaces. So once again, really thank you much for sharing. And please reach out to Waterblock. They're online. Reach to speak to Atianna today if you would like more information. And we've also posted links in the chat as well during today's conversation. I want to thank our hosts here at Curious at the National Museum of Natural History, Dr. Carly Easter, Director of Education. We met just over a year ago to kind of plot how we could collaborate. So I'm very happy to see today come together. I also want to thank Robert Costello, National Program Outreach Manager, also been a part of these ongoing conversations. Thank you, Karen Fitzgerald, Program Manager and Education here at the museum. Joseph States of the Curious team, and Mark Resfelder and Janelle Cooper, who produced all of these WEL lectures starting in 2020. So thank you very much for your work behind the scenes. I also wanna acknowledge another colleague from ACM, Santawa Boachewa, who my supervisor, who is the Associate Director of Collections and Exhibitions at Anacostia Community Museum. I'm a great champion of the work. So thank you for joining us today. For more information on the museum's ongoing environmental work, please reach out to me directly. Markham, drop my email in the chat. You can also find me at the Urban Waters website at ACM's larger website page. We're moving forward to a really exciting phase in terms of our environmental work. Next year, we're launching the first phase of our next kind of big project. We have our next exhibition coming in May, looking at women's of color and their role in the EJ movement in Washington, DC. So we will be engaged in this work in the next fall into next year. So please stay with us. And once again, thank you for spending a portion of your Saturday with us. And please stay for more conversation. Thank you very much. Take care, everyone.